started. Thanks so much, everyone, for coming to this presentation on raw food made easy. Really excited to be here and see so many people interested in raw foods. My name is Jennifer Cornbleet, and what I'm going to do in this presentation is first introduce myself, let you know why I got interested in the raw food diet and what it is that I do, and then I want to take you through breakfast, lunch, dinner, and dessert, and give you some ideas for some really quick and easy meals that you can make that are delicious and just fast and easy. And then at the end of the presentation, I'm going to show you how to make a delicious tropical fruit tart that you'll all get a taste of. Does that sound good?
Yes.
Good. Are any of you new to raw foods? This is kind of a new concept for you? Two people? Okay, great. And what about conversely, how many of you are interested in incorporating more raw foods into your diet? Okay, a lot of you. Great. And I'm curious too, have any of you heard of Raw Food Made Easy before? From this book? Okay. Great. Well, a lot of you already know about raw food diet, know a little bit about me. But I also want to thank, before we get started, my assistants Jackie, and we've got Giovanna and Jessica. I'm not sure where you guys are. We're helping out.
There you go.
Okay, great. So let me introduce myself. My name is Jennifer Cornbleet, and I live in Oakland, where I've been living for 2 years. I lived in Chicago for 20 years before that, so it's nice to be living here now and come to this festival. And I got interested in the raw food diet about 15 years ago at the suggestion of a yoga instructor of mine. And I've been a vegetarian for many years. When I was 10 years old, I decided to become vegetarian the way a lot of kids do when they realize where meat comes from. They just want to be vegetarian, and that's what happened to me. But I wasn't healthy about it or anything like that. But my dad was a good cook, and he kind of inspired me to have a love of good food and playing around in the kitchen. But then when I was in my 20s, I met a yoga instructor who introduced me to the raw food diet, and he was a real example of health for me, and I trusted him, and he recommended that I include more raw foods in my diet. So I decided to give it a try, and I didn't really know what to do with it, so I just kept it really simple with smoothies and salads and juices and fruit and things like that. And I decided to just try it for a month and see if I could tell a difference. And after a month of doing that, I noticed a huge difference in how I felt. And I didn't have any major health problems the way some people do who decide to change their diets, but a lot of things I thought were normal totally changed for me when I switched to a natural, unprocessed diet. My skin cleared up, allergies went away, I was sleeping better, I had more energy, so I could really see firsthand that it could make a huge difference in how I felt. So I just began to incorporate it into my daily life. Not 100%. I don't like to be strict about things. People sometimes ask me, do you eat only raw foods, 100% raw foods? And I don't. I eat a very high raw food diet, a lot of raw food, but I incorporate other healthful vegetarian foods in my diet as well. So I don't like to be strict about things, but continuing over the years to incorporate a lot of raw foods in my diet and continue to really like the way it made me feel. So then one summer, many years later, I was a high school English teacher and I had summers off. So I went to the Living Light Institute, which is a raw food chef school in Northern California. Any of you guys heard of Living Light Institute? Okay, great. And so I went out there for one of their summer trainings and being a raw food chef just for fun. And that really opened my eyes to a whole new world. And I discovered that not only is raw food healthy, but it can be incredibly delicious. And if you've tried other kinds of healthy food in the past, if you haven't always liked the taste, you're probably going to love the taste of raw foods. They can be so colorful and flavorful. There's so much variety. It can really be an incredible cuisine. So that experience inspired me to want to switch professions and teach raw food classes full time, which is what I've been doing for the last 12 years, both in Chicago, where I lived till recently, and also in the Bay Area in California, and at the Living Light Institute. I'm one of the instructors there now. And after I'd been teaching for a couple of years, I wrote my first book, Raw Food Made Easy for One or Two People. And the reason I wrote this book is a lot of my students in my classes were saying, we love raw foods, we want to eat more of them, but we need it to be easier. There's a lot of wonderful raw recipes out there, but they're not always easy. You've got sprouting and fermenting and dehydrating and exotic ingredients and expensive equipment, and it can be really overwhelming. So my goal in all of my recipes and classes and my books is to make every recipe under 30 minutes, usually under 15 from start to finish. No fancy equipment, no exotic ingredients. I also made the book for one or two people because a lot of recipe books make, six, eight servings. It takes more time and money to make extra food you don't need. So I try to keep it really, really easy in everything I do. And a lot of the ideas I'm going to give you in this presentation, you'll just see how incredibly easy it can be. I also have a sweet tooth. I love desserts. I have another book just on desserts that I wrote, and I love doing videos to show people what to do. This is hot off the presses. This literally is not on Amazon yet or anything. It literally just came out like yesterday. Raw in a Rush is my latest DVD for soup, salads, and dressings and breakfast. Just really, really quick and easy. So before we get started with the presentation, I just want to mention a couple of special offers that I have just for you guys. And I have a monthly newsletter every month where I send out new tips and recipes and videos and all kinds of things. And I'd love to keep in touch with you that way. So what I'm going to do today is one lucky person is going to get a free book, and one lucky person is going to get a free DVD. And all you need to do is decide you want to sign up for my monthly newsletter. So I'm just going to start that going around, and then Jackie will get it at the end. And one of you is going to get one of these for free, and I hope that others of you will get a book or DVD anyways and have me sign it. The other thing I want to pass around right before I get started that I just want to mention is I've been teaching raw food classes for a long time, everything from afternoon classes to two-week, three-week-long workshops at the Living Light Institute. And I know, especially in today's economy and everything, not everybody can shell out thousands of dollars and take time off work to, you know, go to all these workshops and everything. And it's really important for me to make this accessible to everybody. So what I've been working on for the last 3 years, and it literally is launching on Monday, so you guys are like the first to know, is a raw food online training. And it's a four-month training, although you can do it at your own pace. It's 15 sessions, so if you did one a week, it'd be 4 months, but you can go at your own pace. You have access to it for a year. And you get live interaction with me, videos, text, lessons, assignments, printable recipes. I'm really excited about it. It's really affordable. And so I hope this is a way that people who can't always journey to classes and workshops can join me and interact with me and have a great raw food training. So I'm just going to pass out a little thing about that. And I want to mention, because you guys are the first, the four-month course is normally $175, so it's really affordable. But there's a little discount on here, $50 off if you sign up in the next month, just because it's new. And there's another a discount I want to give just to you guys of $75 off, so it'll only be $100 for the four-month course, if you're one of the first 50 people to sign up. So I'm just going to have that going around, and I'll mention it again at the end, and we'll get started with the talk. You'll see the card on there. The code on there is 50 off. If you enter that code when you sign up, you get $50 off. The code, if you want to try for the $75 off, is just 75 off. So that's not on the card, but you can just remember that. All right, so we're going to get started talking about breakfast, lunch, dinner, and dessert. So first let me mention, because I know a couple of you are new to raw foods, what raw food is, just really briefly, and then we'll get into the meals and things you can make with it. So you might think of raw food as being unheated or not cooked, and it does mean that, but it also just means food in its natural state. Like if you hear the word raw, something that's raw state. So it's food that isn't cooked, but it's also not processed, no like chemicals, preservatives, no white flour, no white sugar, nothing that's been processed in any way or cooked. So that's the definition of raw food. And there's levels, you know, I mean, you could be really purist about it, you could include some other seasonings and fun things in it, you know, there's levels. But the basic foods you'd be eating more of if you're trying to include more raw foods in your diet are fresh fruits, green leafy vegetables, and natural fats like avocados, nuts, and seeds. So those are the basics. Of course, if you're not eating only raw food, which I don't, you might include other healthful vegetarian foods in your diet, like steamed vegetables or baked sweet potatoes or, you know, lentils or brown rice or things like that. And I include some of those foods too, just to round it out. But the basic foods you'd be eating more of are fresh fruits, green leafy vegetables, and natural fats. And there's a lot of nutritional benefits associated with eating those foods in their natural state. And there's actually a lot of different recipes you can make that are very delicious and fulfilling and satisfying. So that's what I want to get into now. And I just want to emphasize that raw foods does not need to be a radical concept. When I first started teaching this 12 years ago, not as many people knew what it was. So be like, what's raw food? Is that sushi? Like, what is raw food? And it's really, all it means is we should be eating more fruits and vegetables, which everybody knows, and raw foods just says we should eat those foods in their natural state without processing them. So it's really pretty simple. Sometimes I think it's funny that we call raw food something special and then just call everything else food. We could just call raw food food. And then other things we think, well, that's cooked food or processed food or, you know, whatever, because it's really pretty basic. Okay. So I want to first just briefly mention what you need in your kitchen to get started, and then we'll get into breakfast. So setting up a raw food kitchen is really easy. The only thing that you need to get started is a knife, a cutting board, a blender, which is what this is, and a food processor. And you can do 90% just with that. If you want to get into juicing, you would need a juicer, but you don't necessarily need to start off with that. Just a blender, a food processor, a knife, and a cutting board. So it's actually easier to set up your kitchen to do raw foods than to do cooked foods. It can be really, really simple. And in terms of what to shop for, you don't need a lot of different ingredients. In the book, I give you a weekly shopping list. Well, first of all, I give you some staples like nuts, dried fruits, seasonings. And what I do is I only shop for those staple ingredients because they heat like once every 2 months. And then all I need to do each week is go get my fresh produce, which I can do at a farmer's market, a grocery store, whatever. And I don't need to be shopping for other things each week except fresh produce. So it really simplifies shopping. And as far as which fresh produce items to get, I give you a weekly shopping list. And what I do to keep things in budget and simple is instead of getting like 20 different ingredients, is I use familiar nutritious ingredients in many different ways. So for example, something like kale, which is a really nutritious green vegetable, you might have it one day in a green smoothie, and the next day in a kale salad, and the next day in a garden vegetable soup. And the kale's gonna taste totally different in all those recipes, but you've just bought kale. You haven't bought, you know, 15 different things. So I try to keep the ingredients relatively simple so you're not buying a million different ingredients and you don't need to get a variety of tastes in textures and recipes. All right, so let me first talk about breakfast. So I recommend keeping the morning meal very light because in the morning, your body doesn't want to spend a lot of energy digesting a heavy meal. And that's something you can test out for yourself. If you eat a really heavy, fatty breakfast, like you know, the typical bacon and eggs or even you know pancakes or anything like that, you might feel full, but you probably are also gonna feel kind of tired because if you've ever had brunch, you feel really tired because all that energy is going to your stomach to digest your food and you don't have any energy left for your brain, your muscles, whatever, and that's why you wanna go to sleep. On the other hand, if you eat a meal in the morning of very light, nutritious foods, light foods, but also really nutritious, you're gonna have a lot of mental energy. You can even exercise after breakfast, you know, if it's a light meal. And I'm sorry, is that going around? Just kind of keep it going around. Okay, great. So you want it to be nutritious, but if it's light, you're gonna have more energy. So the lightest, most nutritious foods you can eat in the morning are fruits and green leafy vegetables. And usually people don't think of eating green leafy vegetables for breakfast, but I wanna show you some ways it can be really tasty. Okay, so the simplest breakfast you can eat is just fresh fruit. You know, just a bowl of berries or mango, an apple, a banana. That's usually what I do when I travel because it's just the easiest thing and it's really light and nutritious. You could also blend together different fruits into a smoothie. One of my favorite fruit smoothies is just one orange, one banana, and a cup of blueberries. And that's all you need, a little water. You don't need anything fancy like, you know, milk replacements and sweeteners or powders. You know, just the fruit and a little water can be a really, really energizing, delicious breakfast. Now, to get some of those green leafy vegetables in there's a couple of different things you can do. If you have a juicer, and like I said, you don't need to start out with a juicer, but if you're into juicing and you have one, that's a great way to get a lot of green leafy vegetables into your diet because you start with a huge bowl of greens and celery, I mean, more than you could ever eat in a salad or even in a smoothie, and that's gonna just become one glass that you can drink in 10 minutes and get all of those vitamins and minerals in your system. You know, so I love juices. It's just a way of making sure I get my greens. One of my favorite juices in the book is just called Green Juice, and it's just got celery, cucumber, kale, those are the main ingredients. If you want it sweeter, you could put an apple in there and some lemon, and that's it. And it's so energizing. If any of you are hooked on coffee, if you start drinking green juice, it really can replace coffee for you and give you that same kind of energy, but much better, kind of even energy. So green juices are wonderful in the morning. If you don't have a juicer or you don't want to take the time to do that because they are a little more time consuming and expensive with all the produce you're using, my favorite breakfast to make, which I make 90% of the time, is a green smoothie. Have any of you guys heard of green smoothies? Okay. They've become pretty popular over the last couple of years as a tasty, easy way of getting more greens into our diets. And basically all they are is you start off with your fruit smoothie. Let's say you've got blueberries, oranges, and bananas in there, okay? And then you add a handful of any kind of green right to your blender. So it could be light flavored greens like romaine lettuce or celery. It could be medium flavored greens like spinach or chard. Or it could be dark, bitter greens, which are the most nutritious, like kale, collards, you know, or arugula or dandelion greens or something like that. Or you could do a combination, like a little romaine and celery so it's not too bitter, and a little kale, which is usually what I like to do. And then you blend it up. And because you're blending it, you're breaking down the fibers, which for people who aren't used to chewing a lot of greens all the time, it can make it just really easy to digest. It can let you get more of it in than if you were chewing it. You're also not adding any salt or oil to it the way people often do to their salads. And you're not adding any, you know, sugar or dairy products to it the way as often in commercial smoothies you get at coffee shops and things. So it's just fruit and greens, really healthy and nutritious. As you get used to the taste of the greens, you can gradually add less fruit and more greens. So, you know, as your taste buds adjust, you can kind of reverse that ratio so it's more and more green. But it doesn't have to start out super green. You can also even cover up the color with blueberries. Like if you're giving it to a child who doesn't like the green color, just make a blueberry one with spinach and it'll be purple. You won't even see it. They won't even know they're getting a whole serving of spinach in their breakfast. You know, it'll just be a blueberry smoothie. But I like the color green in them. But it still tastes really light and fruity and delicious. Now, if you don't want it fruity, let's say you're having it for lunch or you want it savory, you just don't want it sweet, instead of fruit, you could use cucumbers, celery, tomatoes, and red bell pepper as your base. And it could be more like a vegetable cocktail. And you could even put a little lemon and garlic in that or something like that. So there's so many different flavor possibilities. And in my book, I've got a whole chapter on green smoothies, all different kinds that you can make, like, you know, over 15 different kinds for every day of the week. And a couple of my favorites I'll mention. One I love because the ingredients are available year-round and it's really inexpensive is apple-banana green smoothie. It's just like one apple, one banana, handful of spinach and kale, and some water. You know, just couldn't be easier. If you like it frosty, you can use a frozen banana. Just put it in your freezer. And that's just like the easiest thing that I kind of return to every day. Sometimes I use a pear instead of an apple. Another one that I love for like a special treat, and kids love this one, is a chocolate green smoothie. And it has no dairy, no fat, no refined sugar in it or anything. And the chocolate covers up the color of the green, so it's like you're drinking a mocha or chocolate milk or something. But basically all that one is a banana, a couple of dates for sweetness, cocoa powder. You can use organic unsweetened cocoa powder or even raw cocoa powder you can get nowadays, and some water, and greens, spinach and kale. That's it. And it's not that sweet because the cocoa's kind of bitter, and other than the fruit, I'm not adding any other sweeteners. And it's just, it kind of reminds me of having a coffee or a mocha in the morning, but again, I'm getting all this kale in there and I would never even do it. So that's kind of like a special treat for me. Now that we're moving into fall, another one I love in the book is called Fall Green Smoothie. That's got pear and cranberries. You don't need to cook them or add sugar to them. You just put them in your blender, fresh cranberries. Pear, cranberries, red grapes, and collards and kale. And it's just really, really delicious and nutritious. So I love green smoothies. And actually, this is reminding me, now that I'm mentioning the green smoothie chapter, I just want to mention for those of you, do any of you have the first edition of this book? Okay, what do you do? This is the revised edition, which just came out this past month. And I just want to tell you what's different about it for those of you that have the original. I published the original in 2005, and a lot has changed since then in the raw food world, in the old recipes I've been developing, a lot of things. The first book is still great, but I wanted to add more. So what this edition has is over 60 new recipes that are not in the original at all. It has everything in the original, but 60 more recipes. And it's also got that chapter on green smoothies. And it's got a chapter called Raw on the Go, because more of us are busier than ever and traveling more than ever. There's a whole chapter on how you take it with you, whether it's a lunch to work or you're going for 2 weeks to another country or traveling or whatever. How do you stay healthy and do that? And actually, it's easier with raw foods than with cooked foods because you don't need to worry about cooking them. So it's actually pretty easy. So that's what's new about that. Anyway, okay. So breakfast, you could do fruit, you could do juice, you could do green smoothies. If you do want something a little bit heartier, I've also got a chapter on cereal in there. And the way I make my cereals is, you know, if you get box cereal, it's so bad for you because it's got like flour and sugar and it's just like refined carbohydrates. So the way I make cereals in this book is with nuts and seeds instead of refined carbohydrates. So a couple of my favorites. One is a granola. And all you do is you soak overnight a couple of different kinds of nuts and seeds, just what you want to have the next day. So I like pecans, sunflower seeds, and almonds, just a little bit. You soak that overnight to make it process easily in your processor. Then the next morning, you just drain it and rinse it off. And then you process that with a little bit of dried fruit to sweeten it. It could be figs, raisins, or dates, and a pinch of salt and a pinch of cinnamon until it has a granola-like texture. And I just serve that with a non-dairy milk and some blueberries. And it's just, it takes like 5 minutes, and it's really easy. Now, if you want more of a porridge instead of a crunchy cereal, one of the recipes in my book is called multi-seed porridge. And the way you make that is you, in a coffee grinder, you grind up flax seeds. Has anyone ever heard of doing that to sprinkle flax seeds onto things to get more omega-3s? Okay, so you grind those up in a little coffee grinder. And then I like to add some other seeds too, like, has anyone heard of chia seeds? They're also really high in omega-3s. You could add some of those. You could add hemp seeds, high in protein, sunflower seeds, pumpkin seeds, just a variety of seeds in your coffee grinder. As long as it's about 1/3 part flax, it can be any other seed. So you grind that up, and I keep that on hand in my refrigerator to sprinkle onto my salads too, just for extra nutrition. But to make a cereal out of it, you just whisk in a non-dairy milk, like almond milk, until it's got a porridge-like consistency. And put a little cinnamon in there and just whisk it in, and then have some berries with it or bananas, whatever, and it's like a porridge, but instead of grains, it's got those superfood seeds in there, like chia seeds and hemp seeds and flax seeds. It's really, really tasty. Does anybody have any questions so far about breakfast? Yeah.
Do you soak the seeds or the hemp?
Do you soak the seeds? For the porridge, no, you grind them in a coffee grinder, and that breaks them down and makes them easy to digest. But for the granola, I soak them, yeah.
Do you hydrate the nuts and seeds after you soak them?
Do you hydrate the nuts and seeds after you soak them? No. I like to keep it easy. By the way, nothing in my book is dehydrated, just because that's not 30 minutes or less. So the nuts and seeds, I soak them, and then you just pulse them. And they're not that wet. You know, they just have a... Once you combine them with the milk you're going to have them with anyway, they're going to get wet anyway. So, yeah. Question?
Yeah, quite a long, long time ago, there was this whole thing, whenever you went to a workshop like this, they warn you, don't mix vegetables and fruits. The enzymes will kill you.
Yeah, let me just mention about food combining for a minute. And let me first say, I'm not a health professional or anything like that. My specialty is making it taste good, but I can just speak from my own experience and what I've heard. Combining fruits with greens, they're both such easy to digest foods, especially when they're blended. You're not going to have any problem. I've never seen anyone have any problem with that. The only thing I've seen people sometimes have a problem with, and it depends on the individual's digestion, is sometimes having fresh fruit at the end of a meal, especially if it's a fatty meal or a cooked meal. Fruit wants to digest really quick, and sometimes that can make people a little bloated if you have fresh fruit for dessert. Not everybody, but some people. So that's the main thing to be aware of, but in terms of fruits with greens, no problem.
Have you heard this?
I have heard that, but I don't think that's like really the current thinking now. Yeah, but yeah, and you can test it out for yourself. I've never noticed a problem by blending fruits with greens. In fact, I think that having the greens in there kind of slows the absorption of all that fruit sugar in your system. And the fruit's just kind of there to flavor it. You know, it's more of a green fruit. Yeah.
Just a question, when it comes to blending versus juicing, is blending better because you juice something and you get rid of the fiber?
Okay, good question. So yeah, what about blending versus juicing? Blending would preserve the fiber, so which is better? And they're just different. I like to do both. If I could only do one, I would do blending just because it's easier and it's cheaper and all that, you know. But the reason I like to do both is with juicing, yes, you're taking out the fiber, but A, on a raw food diet, you're getting so much fiber in your diet, it's really not an issue. And the advantage to taking it out of that one recipe is that you can get so many more greens in there than you ever could otherwise. So it's almost like a supplement to your diet just to get that extra green in there. And also without the fiber, it's like instantly digested just like water, so it's just like instant absorption. So they just kind of serve different functions. They're both good. But smoothies are more filling because of the fiber, and that's good too. So they're just different.
What kind of coffee grinder? Like Black & Decker, or what are your favorite brands?
Brands of a blender and food processor? Yeah. So the most expensive ones you can get, I'll go from that to the cheapest, which are great, but you don't have to start with these at all, but I just happen to have them here. The Vitamix is a high-speed blender, which allows you to puree things completely smoothly and also do a large volume because it holds 8 cups, so that's great. If you don't want to invest in a Vitamix because it is like $450, my favorite less expensive blender, and this is the one I use in my DVDs, is a KitchenAid, and you can get it at Target. And it's really quite good, and it costs like $75. And it's a pretty good blender. I mean, it's very good. After that, I would say next cheaper even than $75, but also pretty good, is the Oster Classic. It's an old blender, and it's pretty good too, but the KitchenAid's a little more horsepower than that. So those would be my picks for that. For food processor, which is what you use to grind things that are chunky, like granola or something, you know, whereas the blender's for totally smooth things. So with the food processor, Cuisinart is my favorite. And it's about $175, and I recommend getting a large one. This is a 14-cup size because you can just do more in a larger size. But for a cheaper one that's also quite good at Target, you can get a Hamilton Beach food processor, and they run between $30 and $60, depending on size. Does that answer your question?
Comparison between $30 and $50, is it as good as the Cuisinart?
Not as good as the Cuisinart, but it'll do the job, you know, if you don't want to invest in the Cuisinart.
So it's for less cups?
Well, no, they have a big one. It's just not as much horsepower, so it won't grind things as finely. Yeah, it'll be a little bit chunkier.
Actually, I have to beg to differ about the Hamilton Beach because I've had a horrible problem with that. I bought it from Target several years ago before I bought 14 cup Cuisinart processor, which was so much better.
Okay.
And I've had the Cuisinart for probably about 7 or 8 years. I haven't had a problem with it at all. My grandmother had Cuisinart of the same size for about 30 years and never had a problem.
Okay, good.
But the Hamilton Beach within.
So it didn't last as long. Okay.
No, not only that, the Hamilton Beach within about a year after I used it, I was making a raw fruit. Some kind of fruity pie, and the center of the processor that surrounds the blade actually melted into the pie, into the pie filling. So I had a lot of melted plastic in my filling, and it tasted pretty horrible. I was making for a potluck, and
Hamilton Beach.
Yeah, it was actually a combination of the food processor and the blender in one package.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've never used that machine.
So I brought it back and talked to Danny.
I've only used the Hamilton Beach food processor. I haven't used that, so I don't know.
So the Hamilton Beach was a nightmare. It was a bomb
in the barrel. All right. Well, I'll just tell you guys, I've used both. I like the Cuisinart better, of course, but I have used just the regular Hamilton Beach food processor, like when I travel and I don't want to take this with me, and it's okay. You know, it's okay. But okay, good. Sometimes it's good to invest a little more and have it last, definitely. All right, so let's move on to lunch and dinner. One more question.
You mentioned you soak your seeds and nuts the night before. I heard you should soak all seeds and nuts.
Okay, let me just.
Night before the. I don't do it.
Okay, let me just talk about soaking nuts and seeds briefly, and then we'll move on. So the reasoning behind soaking them overnight in water, there's a couple of reasons. Number one, it makes them easier to digest, because there's mild enzyme inhibitors in the skins and mild tannins, like in walnuts there are, that, you know, for some people it's easier to digest if you're soaked. Also, it lowers the calorie and fat content because water doesn't have any fat or calories, and you're infusing it with water and you kind of get them to eat more nuts, you know, it's the same amount. And it also makes it process to the correct consistency in your processor or blender depending on the recipe. Now, I don't soak them all the time. I kind of only soak them if it's necessary from a culinary perspective, just being practical about it. So, like, for example, in this pie crust I'm going to make, I'm not going to soak it because it would be soggy. But if I'm making a granola or a pate, a dip or spread, then I am going to soak it because it works for the recipe. So I kind of do both, just depending on the culinary, you know, necessity of it. All right, so we talked about breakfast. So now I'd like to move on to lunch and dinner. So the first thing I want to talk about is, what if you want to take your lunch with you to work? How do you do that if you don't always want to take a big salad with you, which can be kind of cumbersome sometimes? So the first thing you can do is make a raw soup. And a soup is like a smoothie, but with vegetables instead of fruits. So you blend together different watery vegetables, like zucchini, you could do cream of tomato, cream of zucchini, cream of cucumber. That could be your base. You could add greens to it, like if you want a cream of spinach soup. So you use watery vegetables and greens. Then you use some water, because you don't want your soup to be too strong. It's not like a salad dressing. You want it to be fairly mild, so you thin it out with water. Then you add some lemon. Lemon really perks up the flavor of greens, so they're not too bitter. So a little bit of lemon, or orange juice, or lime juice. Then you add a little bit of salt, or what I like to add instead of salt sometimes is miso, which is a fermented soybean paste. And that gives soups a lot of depth, as if they have like stock or bouillon in them, just a little bit of miso. So that's a great alternative to salt. And then whatever seasonings you like, could be onion, garlic, you know, whatever. And then to make it creamy, I add about half an avocado for a whole blender full of soup. And that's going to turn it into cream of whatever soup without adding dairy products. And it takes 5 minutes. It's delicious. It's a nice alternative to salad. I'm just going to show you a couple of soup pictures here. This is a cream of tomato soup, just made with tomatoes and avocado. That's it. Really easy. And that's a papaya lime soup, so that's a fruit soup. This is different because it's not a soup in a blender, and I'm going to talk more about how to make pasta out of zucchini later, but this is ramen on the cover, and those noodles are zucchini instead of wheat noodles, and they're in a miso broth, and it tastes just like ramen. So there's a lot you can do with raw soups. I like to take them with me in a jar, and I can even drink them, you know, if I can't eat it with a spoon. It's a really good, easy to transport lunch. The other thing that I'll take with me on the go is I'll make a dip or a pate. A pate in the raw food world is a dip made from soaked nuts and seeds and other seasonings in the food processor. And one of my favorites is called not tuna pate. And it's made with sunflower seeds and almonds processed, and you add lemon juice, parsley, celery, onion. Kind of looks like tuna salad. And I like to take that with me in a little container with some cut up vegetable sticks or a crudité, and then I can just eat it like finger food, and it's easier than eating a salad. So between my soup and my dip and my veggies, like that's a lunch I can just take with me anywhere, and it's really filling and satisfying. Now, if you do want to make a more elaborate sit-down lunch or dinner, you can totally do that with raw recipes. You might make a soup or a salad as your first course, and then a main dish, an entree with a side dish, and even a dessert. So I want to talk you through some of those different kinds of recipes, too. Okay, so we've talked about soups. That could be a great first course, especially if you're tired of having salad all the time. I won't talk about salad for too long, because that's usually what people think of when they think of raw foods, but I've got an extensive salad section in the book, and I try to give you a lot of variety there, like Caesar salad and grapefruit avocado salad and Greek salad. There's a lot you can do. But where I really like to get variety with my salads is by making different salad dressings. And of course you can keep it really simple with just a little lemon juice or olive oil, and I often do that. But I like to make a couple of different creamy dressings to have in my fridge at the beginning of the week so I can always be enticed to eat more salad and get more variety in my salads. So I've added a lot of new salad dressings to this new edition, so I'll just mention a couple of them. Now, one type of dressing I tried to add here is for people who are trying to avoid oil, because I know nowadays a lot of people don't want to have so much oil in their diet. And when you get fat from other sources like avocados or nuts or seeds, it doesn't have quite as many calories as straight oil, and you're also getting other nutrients in there too, whereas straight oil is just kind of pure fat. So you can easily do dressings with whole food fat. So for example, tahini lemon dressing, or avocado lime dressing is one of my favorites. You just blend avocado with water and lime juice and herbs, and it's not that much fat because it's thinned out with the water. If you want a totally fat-free dressing, one of my favorites in the book is mango red bell pepper dressing, and the only ingredients is one mango, one red bell pepper. That's it. You just blend that, and it's thick and creamy. It's so easy. You could add a little balsamic vinegar to it if you want to, but it's just that. So lots of different dressings. One of my favorite richer creamy dressings is called cashew ranch, or just ranch dressing, and it's made with soaked cashews instead of sour cream, and when you blend those with onion powder and garlic powder and fresh herbs, it tastes kind of like Hidden Valley ranch dressing, but it doesn't have any dairy products in it. So there's so many different kinds of dressings that you can make if you want to have a salad, either as your main dish or your first course to a meal. All right, so you've got your soup and your salad. Now let me talk for a minute about raw food main dishes, because this is where a lot of recipes get really complicated. You've got burgers and pizzas and lasagnas, and you've got sprouting and fermenting and dehydrating, and it can be really overwhelming. So I want to give you some ideas for some really quick and easy raw food main dishes. So the first thing I'd like to do is to use the techniques of stacking, stuffing, and rolling to take very simple ingredients and make them visually appealing. So let me give you an example of that. Stacking, to show you a picture here of one of my favorite main dishes called tomato stacks. Okay, stacking. And what that is there is, remember that not tuna pate I mentioned? So those are tomato slices layered with not tuna pate, and also layered with a little pesto, which is another dip made from walnuts and garlic. But you could also just layer it with more pate if you don't have pesto on hand. Topped with some sprouts. And I could have tossed all of that together in a salad bowl, but it wouldn't feel as much like a main dish to people as if I like stacked it. But that's really easy to do. So stacking is one way you can make things look more elegant. Stuffing, you could take that same not tuna pate or another dip and stuff it into a hollowed out tomato. You could stuff it into a red bell pepper half and just eat that with your hands like finger food. You could stuff it into a romaine lettuce leaf and put sprouts and cucumbers and tomato, and it's like a little burrito or a sandwich. And in fact, I've got a whole sandwich section with lettuce, wraps type of, instead of bread in the book. You could stuff it into a hollowed out cucumber. So stuffing is another way to make like a finger food out of really simple ingredients. And I'll just show you a picture of one of these sandwiches in here. Let me see here, sandwiches, here we go. So this is a hummus sandwich, and this hummus is made out of zucchini instead of beans, just to keep it raw. But it tastes just like hummus. You really cannot tell the difference. And it's just rolled up in lettuce with olives and red bell pepper, and it's a wonderful like lunch substitute, so instead of a sandwich. Okay, so stuffing. So stacking and stuffing. Now rolling, one of my favorite rolled entrees is California rolls, and I'll show you a picture of that. That's where you use nori seaweed, and you wrap it around. By the way, let me just show you a picture of, there we go, salad dressings. That's that cashew ranch dressing I mentioned that tastes like Hidden Valley Ranch, but it's made out of cashews. It goes kind of hard to see, sorry. Okay, so rolling, California rolls, you use nori seaweed, and you roll it around vegetables, and you can put pate in there too, and it's like an appetizer or even a main dish. Another one of my favorite rolled entrees is garden wraps, and it's hard to see that, but that's just using collard leaves wrapped around lightly marinated vegetables. So stacking, stuffing, and rolling, you take very simple ingredients that you may already have on hand and make something visually appealing out of it that feels like a main dish. Now the other thing that you can do for a raw food main dish is pasta. So let me just talk about that for a minute. Now, usually people think of pasta as being such a quick, easy meal, you know, all you gotta do is boil water. But actually, you can make raw pasta in less time than it takes to boil water. It's actually even faster. And usually, I'll just show you a couple pictures and talk about it. That's a zucchini pasta with marinara sauce and not meatballs. And this is that ramen soup I mentioned, the zucchini noodles. So I'll tell you how to make those noodles in a minute. So usually when people like pasta, what they really like is the taste of the sauce and the al dente texture. It's not like wheat pasta tastes like that much. It's really the sauce and the texture people like. And you can create that with zucchini because zucchini is a pretty bland vegetable. And when you cut it the right way, it's gonna have a tender al dente texture and it's gonna absorb the flavor of whatever sauce you put it with. So this marinara sauce I showed you is made by processing fresh tomatoes, red bell pepper, and sun-dried tomatoes to make it thick in a food processor with herbs and spices. It tastes just like slow-simmered marinara sauce. You could toss your noodles with pesto. You could toss them with that cashew ranch dressing to make like an Alfredo noodle. You could toss them with mock peanut sauce made out of almond butter and add other veggies for an Asian noodle. Or you could put them in a miso broth with other vegetables like the ramen. So if you have the sauces on hand, even if you don't, it's a 15-minute meal. But if you do, it's literally a 2-minute meal. And the way you make the pasta, if you don't have any special gadget, you can do it just with a vegetable peeler. And you start with a peeled zucchini and you just keep peeling it into ribbons. And it's gonna look like zucchini fettuccine and taste great with the sauce. Or there's also this little gadget you can get called a spiral slicer. And it costs about 20 bucks, and you can get them at cookware stores or online. And you put in the zucchini and turn the handle and it comes out like angel hair pasta. So between stacking, stuffing, rolling, and pasta, you can have a really, really easy main dish. Okay, so now I wanna mention vegetable side dishes. What do you serve on the side? And usually people think that vegetables like kale, you know, oh, I can't eat that raw, it's too chewy, it's too crunchy, see salad or whatever. But I want to share with you some tricks for actually making those vegetables taste like you steamed or stir-fried them. But it's even faster than steaming or stir-frying, and you preserve more nutrition and even color and flavor. So, for example, kale. If you want to make kale really tender, what you do is, first of all, you cut it into really thin strips. I'm just going to find a picture for a minute. You cut it into really thin strips, maybe take off the stem if it's tough, cut it into thin strips, and that's already going to break it down. Then the next thing you do is instead of gently tossing it with a dressing, because you don't want the kale to wilt, like with salad, you gently toss it with dressing because you don't want it to wilt. Well, you want the kale to wilt. Can't find this picture here. Oh, there we go. You want the kale to wilt. That's what happens when you steam or stir fry it. The fiber breaks down and it like condenses and wilts. So what you do is you get in there with your little bit of lemon juice and olive oil and salt or whatever, and you massage it with your hands for like 1 minute. Just rub it down, and it's gonna condense down just like you steamed or stir-fried it. So like this picture here, this is Mediterranean kale with olives and red bell pepper, and that kale is massaged, literally for just 30 seconds to a minute with the dressing. So don't steam, don't fry your vegetables, just massage them, and they're gonna taste just like you cooked them. Right here, this carrots with Moroccan spices, tastes like a braised carrot dish. Thinly sliced carrots massaged in a little orange juice, lemon juice, olive oil, salt and pepper, parsley. You could add some golden raisins, you could add cumin, cardamom, you could flavor it in all different ways. Here, Latin American cabbage, again, it's massaged to taste really tender. And on the back, I know it's hard to see, but shaved beet salad, thinly sliced beets massaged. They taste like steamed or roasted beets. Your hands will be pink after doing this, but massage. And here you've got, I was talking about stuffing, there you've got a stuffed mushroom stuffed with sun-dried tomato pate to make a little main dish out of it. All right, so those are just some ideas for some vegetable dishes on the side. Does anyone have any questions so far?
Yeah. I saw in your store out there, wasn't a spiralizer or some other thing that makes the henyaja and zucchini in there?
Yeah.
It had a different title. So what's yours from that one?
And that, it might have been called the spiruli. There's another gadget, spiruli. S-P-I-R-O-O-L-I, spiruli. That's another gadget. And it makes more of a spaghetti. It just goes in a different way. It's a great tool. They're both great. It's just different. But it makes it a little bit of a wider noodle. It's more of a spaghetti rather than like an angel hair. But they're both really good. They're both fine. Anything else? Other questions? Yeah.
Zucchini, when you make the pasta, do you have to take the seeds out or you just go right through?
Okay, the zucchini, do you have to take the seeds out? Now, if you're doing it with a peeler, I just stop when I hit that bed of seeds and then go on all sides. But when you do it in one of these gadgets, the seeds automatically are left behind, so you don't have to worry about it. Yeah. Other questions? All right. Are you guys ready for dessert?
Yeah.
Make some dessert. Where is that? Is that sign-up sheet going around still? Did everybody get it? Okay, great. And did everybody get a card? You wanted one? Mm-hmm. Anybody not going? Okay, great.
We have a call.
All right. Huh? Oh, go ahead. Thank you. Okay, so we're going to make some dessert, and then we'll determine the winner of the book and the DVD. Okay. So let me just talk for a minute about desserts before we get into making this one. I really love raw desserts. Like I said, I have a whole other book out on raw desserts. And what I like about them is a lot of people these days are trying to avoid certain ingredients like white flour, white sugar, dairy products, saturated fat. And raw desserts are already free of all that. So you don't have to wonder, is it dairy-free, is it gluten-free, does it have refined sugar? It doesn't. And a lot of people are trying to avoid those ingredients. So if you bring a raw dessert to a party, they're not even going to care that it's raw. They're just going to be so happy to have a dessert that doesn't have those things in it that they think all desserts have to have. So people are going to love you if you make it a raw dessert and bring it to a party. So I love that. And raw desserts are so easy. I've always loved to cook, but I never really liked to bake. I've never really been good at it, rolling out pie dough, and it's too scientific. I've never been that good. Well, anyone can make an incredible raw dessert. You don't have to be good at baking. It's so easy, and yet they look so gourmet and decadent. So I like that. And any dessert you can make cooked or baked, you can make raw. Cakes, cookies, ice creams, anything. There's just some basic substitutions. In general, dried coconut and nuts take the place of flour and butter. And dried fruits and other natural sweeteners take the place of sugar. And avocados take the place of cream, butter, and eggs. And it might seem strange to use avocado in a dessert, but if you think about it, cream, butter, and eggs don't really taste like anything. They just make things rich. And that's what the avocado does. You don't even know it's there. It's just rich and creamy. I won't show you now because I've got my gloves on, but there's a picture of a chocolate mousse in the book that looks and tastes just like chocolate mousse, and it's made with avocado instead of cream and butter that you would never, ever know. And I even made that chocolate mousse for some people in Paris who like really know chocolate mousse, and they were totally skeptical, and they just could not even believe it. Mm-hmm. So it really does. Okay. So what we're going to make now is a tropical fruit tart. And we're kind of at the end of summer, so these ingredients are not going to be in season much longer, so I really wanted to make this dessert. And what I love about this dessert is it doesn't have any refined sugar in it. It's only sweetened with fresh and dried fruit. There's not even any like honey or maple syrup or agave. It's just fresh and dried fruit, so no refined sugar. And it's so easy. So we're going to start off by making the crust, okay? So I've got a food processor. I know it might be hard to see me, so I'll try to describe exactly what I'm doing. If you need to stand up or look, feel free. Now I'm using a food processor to make the crust. So first I'm going to add some dried coconut. And that's going to take the place of white flour. And it's also going to lighten the crust, because sometimes if a crust only has nuts, it's just a little dense and heavy. It's just a little lighter. So dried coconut. I'm also going to add some walnuts, which are high in omega-3s. If you don't like walnuts, you can use pecans, almonds, any macadamia nuts, any nut that you like. Just make sure they're raw.
Are they soaked?
They're not soaked, otherwise it'd be soggy. All right. Then I'm going to add a pinch of salt, just to give it a kind of buttery flavor. And then I'm going to process that until it's coarse crumbs. So go ahead and do that. All right. Now I've got to bind the crust together and sweeten it. So what I'm going to do is add some dates. And these are medjool dates. Which are very soft and sweet. I just removed the pits with my thumb and fingers. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and add some of those. This recipe in the book, by the way, is called Coconut Crust. and, I'm sorry, walnut crust. And I'm going to go ahead and process that. Okay, now I'm just looking for it to start to stick together. It's not going to like be a ball, that would be too doughy. It's just it's starting to stick together, that looks great. Okay, so now I'm ready to shape it. Isn't that easier than making a pie crust with flour and butter? And, you know, it's obviously not good for you, but it's hard, so this is easy. Okay, and shaping it is even easier because you don't need to roll it out. Now I'm going to use a tart pan, and you could also use a pie plate. I already have one made in a pie plate, but we're going to do one in a tart pan, which is just as easy. It just looks a little more elegant because you've got those fluted edges. And it's got a removable bottom, so we're going to be able to unmold it too. All right, so I'm just going to pour the crumbs into the tart pan.
Did you soak the dates?
I did not soak the dates or the nuts, otherwise it would have made the crust soggy.
Right.
Okay. So now the first step is I'm just going to distribute those crumbs around the bottom of the pan with my fingers before I start pressing too much, because once I press, you can't really move them around much. That's the rest of my crust here. Okay, so distribute that around, kind of make a little lip going up the sides. I'll hold this up when I'm done because I know it's hard to see. Okay, and then I'm just going to press down. And pressing down on the bottom, especially firmly where the bottom meets the sides, so that when I cut it, I've got a nice angle there, even there. Okay. And I could freeze this crust like either in crumb form in the freezer for up to 3 months or already pressed into the pan too. I could freeze it if you have extra pans and just want to have a pie shell ready to go. Okay, so now that I've pressed down the bottom, now I'm going to press down. Okay, now I'm going to press down the sides. So I'm just pressing the sides against the fluted edge. It would be the same if I were using a pie pan, just using my fingers and thumb to guide me. All right, that was good. Wasn't that easy? Mm-hmm. Now, normally I would chill this. We're not going to today, but I would put this in the freezer just for like 10 minutes while I make the filling. Just because whenever you process something in a processor and then press it with your hands, it warms it up a little bit and softens it up a little bit. So it's going to firm back up when I chill it. Those dates are going to set. It's going to be fine, and it just has a nice texture when you kind of let it reset by putting it in the freezer or the refrigerator, you know, for 15 minutes. Okay, we'll set that aside, that's ready to go. And now we're gonna make the filling. Now this filling is amazing because it only has one ingredient, mango. And two ingredients. It's got fresh mango and dried mango. And the trick is that the dried mango, when I blend it with the fresh, you're not gonna see it, it's gonna look like mango, but it's gonna thicken it because that dried mango has a lot of pectin in it and it's gonna make it set. When we taste it today, it'll still be a little bit soft, but if you chill it for 2 hours, it gets really firm and you can make a nice clean slice. And so the dried mango, I just cut up with the scissors into little pieces to make it easier to blend, and I soaked it in water for 10 minutes. Now the reason I soaked the mango is because that needs to blend creamy, whereas the dates, you know, didn't, so that's why I soaked the mango. All right, so first I'm going to add some fresh mango to my blender. And you can use, this is frozen organic mango, just because fresh wasn't ripe and readily available, but of course you could use fresh if it is. All right, so I just thawed it out overnight, just frozen organic mango.
So when we buy fresh mangoes, we can just freeze them for when we need them?
You could do that. If you buy fresh mango, you could chop it up and freeze it for later, definitely. All right, so we've got the mango. I'm making enough for two pies here, so we have enough for everyone to taste.
How many cups are you using?
How many cups? Well, in the recipe, it's it's 2 cups, so this is 4 because I'm doubling. Yeah.
And how many dry?
I think it's like 1 cup. Yeah, the recipe's in the book. I'm making a different amount because I'm making it for.
What if you didn't make it dry? It wouldn't be as thick?
Yeah, if you just blended the fresh, it would be really watery. So this is what's going to make it thick. All right, so we're going to blend those two things together. Let's get the lid. I'm going to make a little noise for a minute.
Did you dehydrate the mango, or did you?
I didn't dehydrate the mango. I bought it already dried. If you look in the bulk section near raisins and dates, you can get pieces of dried mango.
So that's what I was wondering. In the bulk section, I think it has sulfur, too.
This is natural, unsweetened, no sulfur. You can usually find that, too. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and process that.
Okay.
color. A little air bubble in there, let me just get rid of it. You could also do this with pineapple. Dry pineapple and fresh pineapple. There we go, little air bubble. All right. All right, that's good. Okay, so now I'm gonna just pour this into the crust. Let me get my crusts over here. Got two of them. And like I said, it'll be a little soft, but this would totally firm up if you just chilled it for a couple of hours. It's still really tasty though. Okay, so we'll go ahead and fill those. You could also have this on its own, just as a mango pudding, if you just want the crust. And it's totally fat-free.
Do you chill it in the freezer or the fridge?
Do you chill it in the freezer or the fridge? Either way, I usually do it in the fridge, but it would be great a little bit partially frozen too.
So I noticed one is fluted and one is just glass, which is better.
Oh, it's just a different look. They taste exactly the same. More people have pie pans on hand, so I just wanted to do both to show you. But I like the look of the tart pan a little better. But they're both fine.
Will that get soft again after you've chilled it if it sits out? Should I get a hot
dog? Will it get soft again if it sits out after you chilled it? It would take a long time. It'll be okay for a couple of hours sitting out, you know, after you've chilled it. Okay, so now I'm just going to spread the filling. Does this look good? Mm-hmm. Everyone's going to get a taste of this.
Is it better to put it in the freezer or the fridge?
I would put it in the refrigerator, but you could freeze it if you particularly want it to taste like a frozen dessert. You know, but I usually just put it in the refrigerator. Okay.
So, I just have a quick question about it.
Yeah.
Refrigerated. Is the pectin?
Uh-huh.
Is the pectin content in the mango gelatinized in the refrigerator the way pureed blueberries would?
Blueberries also get firm when they're refrigerated. Same with mango. It's going to get really firm when it's refrigerated. All right, so now we're going to just top this with some berries. And you could totally just arrange them perfectly, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to. They still look good, though. Just I like to keep it easy. So just put them on top. You could also do these in, like, individual pie plate, you know, tart pans, if you want, like, just an individual dessert to look really elegant. And that's it, really easy. I'm gonna unmold this tart now.
You can make it into a parfait.
You could do a parfait, you can layer it in a glass with the berries. So like I said, I chill this, but let me just unmold it for you guys. It's gonna be fine. There you go. Let me just get you guys started, and then I'll come back for questions for a minute. So what you guys can do, okay, is just use a couple of spoons and kind of spoon out a little bit for everybody in those cups. And doesn't need to look, it's not going to look perfect anymore. We're just going to spoon it out for you guys and then give everybody a sample with a cup. All right, so does anybody have any questions while they're doing that? Yeah. Okay, so yeah, the reason I use the dry mango, let me have everyone's attention while we're doing questions, otherwise it's hard to hear. The reason I did the dry mango too is just fresh would be totally watery. It would just be like, you need it to thicken. Yeah.
How long did you soak the dry mango for?
I soaked the dry mango for 10 minutes, that's it. Just enough to soften it up a little bit. Yeah.
You normally wear gloves when you're doing the raw food cooking?
I don't wear gloves at home. I'm just doing that to look more professional. Yeah. Oh, wait a minute.
Shh.
Okay, how long do the dressings last in the refrigerator? It varies. Some made with fresh vegetables, maybe 3 days, but some made with like cashews a week. By the way, every recipe in this book, at the end, it says how long it keeps, so you'll always know that. Another thing I want to mention, I forgot to mention in the beginning, we've got a little sale going on here. I'm going to announce the winner of the book and DVD in just a minute, but even if you didn't win a free one and you want to get one, and I hope you do so I can sign it, they're on sale today. The new Raw Food Made Easy is only $14 instead of $20, and the new DVD, Raw in a Rush, is $15 instead of $20. We've also got my original DVD, Raw Food Made Easy, and my Raw Dessert book here as well, so I hope you'll let me sign those. And where is that newsletter sign up? Let's see here. Okay. Anybody have that?
Are you sure?
Okay. Okay, so. Oh, you just want to sign. Okay, great. And then we're going to have the winner in just a minute.
All right.
And while we're doing that and getting you guys samples, I just want to mention again that I hope that some of you will be one of the first 50 to do this online training with me. You'll get $75 off. Just enter the code 75 off when you sign up. And if you miss that, you'll still get $50 off for another month. Just enter that code. And if you have any questions about it on the website, you can email me and ask me any questions. And any questions you didn't get to ask me here today, you can ask me by emailing it too. All right, so we're going to do the samples. Any other questions while we're waiting for samples?
It has to be within the first month of today, within 30 days of today, to get $75 off.
No, the $75 off is if you're one of the first 50 to sign up. $50 off is within a month from today.
Okay, if you're within the first 50 to sign up.
Yeah, if you're the first 50, it's $75 off. If you miss that, you can still get $50 off. Okay, so what was the amount of coconut versus walnuts in the crust? 1 to 1. So it's like one cup of each. And you, if you don't like coconut for some reason, you could do all walnuts. If you don't like nuts, you could do all coconut. But that is a nice flavor to have one cup of each.
Yeah. If you cook brown rice and potatoes, sweet potatoes, is that too big to cook?
Whole grains and starchy vegetables like sweet potatoes, those really do need to be cooked to be digestible. So I include those foods in my diet too, you know, as well as raw foods.
You don't eat raw sweet potato pie?
You could make raw sweet potatoes, but you know, I don't know. I'm kind of, I like, you could do it, but I like baked.
Will you be signing your book tomorrow too?
Tomorrow I won't be here, but my book will still be here with my publisher at the book publishing company booth.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was it one cup each for the crust?
One cup each of coconut and nuts for the crust. Right. And the dates was a half cup of dates. Yeah. And this recipe is in the book. It's also on my website. Let me mention my website, learnrawfood.com. That's a different site. The card has the site for the course, but my regular website is learnrawfood.com, and this recipe is on there too, and it's topical for you. All right. Without the meat, it's too less than that.